Hello, welcome to episode 8 of Will's Guide. This is my third video for today, which is Saturday, January 27th, 2024. This will be my first day getting three videos done, and I need to do three videos a day to get my kilo tube of YouTube videos done by the end of the year. And so part of this is an exercise of me making videos that are easier or harder, that require more or less preparation, and also trying to expand the notion of what I can make a video about. And part of it is also just trying to get used to making a bunch of videos, getting used to going through the process, and trying to make a video without having to do 50 takes or 76 takes. Like for one of my early videos, I spent all day doing 76 takes and then threw it all away. So I'm going to try to avoid that. I have, 12 minutes before midnight. I want to get this video in the can before midnight. So we're going to finish up, and then I will process the audio and then upload it to YouTube, and we'll just go with it. So I had an idea today when trying to think what are short but potentially useful videos having to do with programming languages that I could make when, you know, I'm not gearing up for some giant thing like macros that might require preparation to talk about, or, you know, showing something fancy with mini Canron that might require some prep. And one thing I thought that I actually wanted to do anyway, and I think is useful, and I keep saying that it's important, so, you know, why don't I follow my own advice, would be to go through the scheme spec. Now, of course, there are different versions of the scheme specification. After thinking about it and looking at R5, looking at R6, and also looking at R7 small, because Shay's scheme is based on R6RS, and that's the scheme I use most, and because Racket also implements something close to R6RS, and that's the version of scheme that I really use for a while now, I would like to go through the R6 spec. And my thinking is, okay, let's go through the specification the way that I went through R5 when I was trying to learn Scheme better. And the way I went through R5 was with Scheme, with a Scheme implementation. In this case, we can use Shay Scheme 9.6. which implements a version of R6RS. And what we're going to do is we're just going to try out in Shay the features that are talked about, the language constructs, the examples, and we're going to both just try to understand what the spec's talking about and make sure that we enter the examples and can get everything to run and, you know, feel like we're confident in understanding it. But we're also going to take a somewhat adversarial mindset, where if the spec says something that must be supported, you know, we're going to try that in Shay, and we're going to see if we can break Shay Scheme, or see if we can get Shay Scheme to give us an answer that doesn't seem to be in compliance with the specification. You know, the corner cases are always interesting. Also, Shay Scheme extends the specification in some ways. There are also interesting cases having to do with errors and unspecified behavior in the scheme, the scheme language, and also in many other languages. So like famously C, the C programming language, has all sorts of unspecified behavior. Scheme also has unspecified behavior. So what I want to do is go through the report very, you know, carefully, not all at once, but a little bit at a time, and try things out, try to understand what the spec is saying, see if I can catch Shay Scheme doing anything that's not apparently not consistent with the spec. And then we can look at the Shay Scheme user's guide and see if there's, you know, a comment there about Shay not being compliant with that part of the spec. So that sort of adversarial thinking, I think, and trying to find the edge cases and make sure you really understand each of the constructs and play around with it in the implementation that you're using, let's say Shay, I think that's really important to understand the language and its implementation well. So that's what I'm going to do. And I think that, you know, so the non-library part, like, you know, the library extensions part of R6 is 90 pages. That's kind of long. I think that's kind of long to go through everything in entirely. But if we look at the table of contents, I don't think it's all that bad, because a lot of these are appendices. You know, there's a formal semantics and operational semantics. That's pretty long. So we could look at that and try to read some of the rules just to try to understand how you read these semantics. We could also look at R5RS, which has a denotational semantics, and we could try to compare the semantics and make sense of that. Probably good practice for me, because, you know, I don't do a whole lot of semantics, so I can kind of read these semantics. Some of these things I can make sense of without too much difficulty, but parts of those, you know, in a complicated language, the semantics are always subtle. So it'd be interesting to look at the semantics. But up to that, it's only 59 pages. So the R5RS spec, the whole thing is 50 pages. And I thought, yeah, maybe we could do that. But I would like to get to know R6 better. I mean, I know it fairly well, but there are changes and extensions. So R6 supports Unicode, for example. R5 didn't. I think there's more specification of the behavior of the macro system, which is very important to Scheme. So, you know, let's look at this report. And so what I'm thinking of doing right now is just going through maybe either one, you know, page of the report, or if there are two pages that kind of fit together, you know, that might be fine in one video. So it'll be a fair number of videos. You know, it could be 50 videos or I don't know, something like that. But hey, we got plenty of videos to spare, so it's not a problem. And I'll try to put the page numbers of the spec in each video title. So if you're interested in learning about some feature of Scheme, an R6 scheme, and you're trying to read part of the specification, you can hopefully find the video. And part of this is just practice of, hey, a specification is just a document. Okay, you can understand it. We can really understand this formal specification of Scheme. We can, if it's just something we don't understand, we can go read Kent's book, you know, the Scheme Programming Language 4th edition. We can also look at the Shea Scheme User's Guide for Shea Scheme 9. And between those three documents and playing around with some experimental programs and typing in examples and all that, we should be able to get a very good sense of how Scheme works and how R6 works, and, you know, fill in any gaps we have, or at least major gaps we have in understanding of the language. And there are parts of R6 I definitely don't know very well that either were added, or maybe I was a little shaky with R5. So, you know, like syntax case, I've never felt very comfortable with that. You know, the concept of like fluid let, you know, that's always been a little iffy in my mind. So there are things like that I would like to fill in. And, you know, that's what we're going to do. So we got 4 minutes left. I don't think we can, you know, go through too much of it right now, other than, you know, just to see that the table of contents, you know, there's an overview that's pretty quick. Requirement levels, okay, I don't know what that is. Talk about numbers, okay, I know that there were changes to the numeric system with R6. Lexical syntax, datum syntax, okay. This is a notation, and let's see what we have. Semantic concepts. Okay, entry format. So this, I guess, I don't know what that is. This maybe tells you what the types of links are. I don't know. Libraries. Okay, so this looks quite different from R5 to me. Top level programs. Okay, so the top level programs can behave differently. The things that you would type at the top level versus expressions that appear in a let, for example, can show different behavior. Primitive syntax, macros, okay. Macros are important. Expansion process, okay. That sounds like for the macros. Base libraries, all right. So I think some of the things in R5 that just were considered part of the language have now been moved into libraries. Libraries are the big addition for R6. There weren't libraries before. So, you know, a lot of these things that would have been in just the base language of R5 are now in the base library. Move to a library, okay. And then there's appendices like the formal semantics, which I believe are operational semantics that are effectively in something like PLT Redux, you can execute them. Sample definitions for derived forms. Okay, so I think this is showing you how you might define macros for parts of the language. Additional material, I have no idea what that is. Example, okay. I think this example has to do with, you know, differential equations or some sort of calculus numeric computation that was in R5. Language changes between R5 and R6. R5 report had something similar between R4 and R5. References, okay. Papers and whatever, to look it up. And then here's the index. Okay. So that's the rough structure. Some of these sections, I don't even know what they mean. I don't understand what requirement levels is. I suspect what this is whether or not an implementation has to support certain things to be considered compliant with the R6RS. That's my guess. But we'll go through this closely and try to understand, you know, the report in detail and try to play around with the forms and the examples and try to make sure we understand the language as well as we can, and also generate questions if there are things that are confusing. It's important that we recognize what we're confused about. So, you know, I'm not going to try to bluff my understanding of things. I want to try to fill in gaps, and maybe you can help me out, you know, if you're watching, because there are plenty of things about Scheme I don't know. All right, that's it. And it's midnight. Okay, so this is the end of the video. I will see you, well, I was going to say tomorrow, but today. Bye-bye.